I'm Richard Browning, I'm founder and chief test pilot from Gravity, and we build these 1,000 horsepower jet suits. The concept was people walking around on 2 feet are actually executing a quite challenging balancing objective without really thinking about it. Given my training background, could I lean on the thrust as the support? Messed around, ended up quite logically with engines on my arms, and then thought, why don't I put an engine on each leg? But it was very hard because you're balancing all four limbs like a sort of puppet. So we moved the leg engines up to the waist area and then eventually consolidated them into one rear engine. Inside here, there's a little rocker switch and you can nudge up and down incrementally the amount of power the whole suit puts out. The trigger in the other arm assembly is just a kind of very crude throttle. You squeeze it a little bit and it just comes onto full power. You can't modulate the power very precisely like you can with this. So in the Guinness World Records we did in 2017, I really tried to turn sharply and I slid down out of the airflow and needed desperately some more power and I couldn't access it because I didn't have that control and ended up falling in the water. At the end of some of the original runs, I'd be flying fast, I'd be very light because I'd burnt through lots of fuel, and I was desperately flaring my arms out to try and avoid climbing. We can avoid all of that now because we've got the throttle nudge switch, as we call it. The obvious visual difference is that nowadays, we're trying to travel fast, we try and generate some aerodynamic lift, even very crudely with this ram air leg wing. As I go faster and faster, the air goes into these, it puffs the leg wing out, and then that lifts my legs flatter, which means the rear engine is now pushing me forwards rather than being used just to lift me up. You could think of these as like the feathers on an arrow. Underneath there is a little kill switch. It's a little latching button to arm the suit. You push it in, then you can hold the trigger down, and then a few seconds later, the engines will start. They come up to idle. If you're wearing the heads-up display, it'll tell you in the heads-up display when the engines are all finished and ready to go. If you want to shut down at any point, hopefully when your feet are on the ground, because you could do it in the middle of the air, but it'd be a bad idea, you just flick that button and everything shuts down. So it's like a sort of emergency shutdown switch, but it's in your control to do when you want. The Harrier aircraft took off by swiveling its nozzles down, then they'd swivel them back and you'd move forwards. We're doing that, but in a much more dynamic way. So we actually take off by accelerating the power, feeling the power out to the sides. If you then start lowering your arms, you gradually get lighter and lighter and lighter, and a bit like a helicopter lifting off, you just drift up. It's healthy to never lose sight of the risk you're taking here. To do anything innovative and new, and hopefully pioneering, you have to go down pathways no one's been before and take some degree of risk. Our rule is that risk has to be recoverable. Even 48 hours ago in testing, I had quite a big crash, and that's an example of where sometimes still things go wrong. In terms of the future, our main focus at the moment is building a race series. We can train clients to fly this in a day, so why not have a bunch of guys and girls, maybe even from different sporting backgrounds, assembling over water to keep it safe and doing it in inner city locations where you've got lakes, rivers and seafronts, and have a sort of real life Ironman race course series to drive that inspiration, entertainment, you know, a bit like Formula One drives all that, and also drive the technology evolution.